Ham Radio Now, episode 166, TAPR and the Beach. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. What do TAPR and the beach have to do with each other, you may be asking yourself? Nothing. TAPR was a couple of weeks ago. We're at the beach. So I'm force-fitting a couple things together in a desperate and probably futile attempt to get you viewers to watch a few different things and not just stick on one favorite thing. The TAPR part of this program is just going to be the introduction. It's just going to take a couple of minutes. Steve Bible will introduce some of the guys who were there at Austin. And then we'll come back here to the beach. This is our mostly annual beach vacation. We're at Holden Beach, North Carolina, and we're going to be here for a week. And when you come to the beach, you set up ham radio equipment. Doesn't everybody? Setting up ham radio equipment here is a little bit difficult because we are at the beach and there's not much of my favorite antenna support, which would be trees. There are no trees here on the beach. There's some inland a little bit, but they don't do me any good. So about the only thing around here that's sticking up out of the ground are the beach houses. And I'm going to put up an 80-meter dipole. It's, you know, 120-foot or so dipole. How am I going to get that here? It's not going to be easy. It's certainly not going to be straight. It's not going to run from one place to another and just be a typical dipole hanging in the air. What I'm going to do is start it down there, maybe on a neighbor's boardwalk, or if the neighbor doesn't want me to hook an antenna on their boardwalk, maybe one of the other posts that's sticking up there along the sand dune. It's going to come up to the side of the house, it's going to run along the face of the house, and then back over to either the other neighbor's boardwalk or a post out there someplace. It's going to be like 3/4 of a loop. And if I could actually get things up in the air on the other side, I might actually make a loop, but I can't. Here's the dipole. This is my trusty field day dipole. It last saw duty, not this last field day, because I was up at the W3AO, W1AW stroke 3 operation, which I still have to edit, and I want to try to get that on the air about the time that field day results get announced. It should be in good shape. I hope it's in good shape. The only part I can't really see are how good the connections are to the center from the twin lead, but we'll find out. Oh, by the way, that's the other magic that we'll do. I'll use that 80-meter dipole on all bands up to 10 meters, maybe even 6 meters, through the magic of twin lead, which we've explained in previous episodes. In fact, I think it's way back like episode 13 or 14. Jeff and I hung this dipole and put stations together for field day. So we're doing the same thing. We're just doing it here at the beach. The magic of twin lead is it's very low loss. So even though the SWR will be through the roof on just about every band, even on 80 meters, because it's we're not doing everything resonant at 50 ohms. We're doing 450 ohm twin lead to a more or less 50 ohm antenna. It's going to be a mess. It'll require a tuner, but because we won't lose energy going back and forth through the twin lead, it's going to work. The stuff I'll use for supporting the twin lead is our good old weed eater line. Remember the dipole episode that everybody was in, Jeff and Bobby and Cindy and I? Weed eater line makes great antenna support, so we'll use that for hanging things off down there and for hanging things off up here. I'll show you what this looks like when we're all done. I'm not going to shoot the whole thing. I've discovered that if you try to shoot video of doing things, things take too long. So we'll put this up and I'll show you what it looks like afterwards. For VHF, UHF, I'm going to have just a magnet mount antenna on a pie pan. Not quite 19 inches, almost, I think it's more like 12 or 13 inches, but it does a pretty good job. And I will just stick it somewhere on a railing and secure it with some bungee cords or something. And downstairs, I have built the entire Ham Radio Now studio. So yeah, I'm here at the beach. This is a working vacation. I'll be doing a lot of editing on the TAPR programs and a few other things that I've got. So yeah, we'll get out there on the beach and walk and ride bikes up and down a little bit, but I'll be spending a lot of time working for you. So for now, Well, tell you what, I want to mention Arvin. I didn't bring Arvin to the beach. Arvin's getting mad at me because I'm not taking him on the road. I'm leaving him watching over the ham shack back at home. But Arvin would like you to stop by hamradionow.tv and put some coins in his little money slot up on the top. Helps us pay for all this stuff and the time it takes to put these programs together. All right, let's go to Austin, Texas, and I'm going to hand things over to Steve Bible. He's going to show you the folks that are involved in TAPR, and then we'll get serious about putting the TAPR videos on online in sometime within the next week or so. There's birds all over the place here. I saw something out of the corner of my eye. I thought somebody was walking on the roof. It's a pigeon. All right, over to Austin, and here's Steve Bible.
Gary, you ready?
We're rolling.
All right, so Gary's rolling. I've said my good mornings, and it looks like we got a pretty enthusiastic crowd here. Has everybody got their water? Everybody got coffee? Everybody fueled up for this morning? I hope so. And it's really a great crowd this morning. We are definitely above average in attendance for the DCC this year. We have well over 100 registered guests, and then typically we have 20 or more that will drop in on us today and tomorrow. So let me start off by saying welcome to everybody. My name's Steve Bible, N7HPR. I'm the president of TAPR. I also want to introduce Larry Wolfgang. Larry, where are you at? And Larry, you want to say a few words for the ARRL? And he's going to come on around here. Of course, he knows that we're going to do this to him, so no surprise. And he's got his notes.
I always have to have notes, otherwise I'll forget which way I'm walking. Well, I want to welcome everybody and extend greetings from ARRL headquarters. We're especially pleased this year in our 100th anniversary to be again part of the DCC. 33 years this has been going on, and so we're happy to be part of that. Just as a show of hands, how many ARRL members do we have in the room? Great. Okay. Awesome. Well, I want to make the point that, you know, for ARRL, you are the American Radio Relay League, and it's not staff or an office up in Newington, Connecticut, but we're there to serve the membership and hopefully to provide you with some good information. So we're pleased to have so many members here. The other thing that obviously I'm not going to miss is QEX. Do we have a few QEX readers in the audience? Okay, great. Not as many hands, so we'll have to work on you. For those who are not QEX readers, over in the demo room, we have some sample copies of the past two issues. So I invite you to pick up sample copies, have a look at what the magazine is like, at least for those two issues. And I'll be here this weekend and look forward to talking to everybody. Ideas, suggestions, things you're doing that might become good articles. That's one of the things that I'm looking forward to here, is talking with everybody. You know, every year I talk about writing for QEX. And I talk to many of you and always looking for, you know, what are you doing? How can you write an article for QEX? And I have an example. For as long as I've been attending DCC, Scotty Cowling and I, you know, exchanged some thoughts and ideas, and I've been encouraging him to write something, anything, just write something for QEX. And he always promised me, yes, yes, I have this idea, I'm going to do this. And so, I keep waiting, and then next year I talk to him again, or we exchange emails along the way. And so he finally wrote an article that we published this spring. And I know that none of his hats fit him anymore, because not only did he get an article in QEX, but he also got the cover, which was pretty neat. And so, but the interesting thing was that he got pretty excited about that whole article and having the cover and, you know, promoting, you know, read my article in QEX and so forth. Well, he wrote me again another article almost immediately that we put in the next issue. And then he was so enthusiastic, he said, I have this idea for kind of like an ongoing series. if you're interested. And so July-August issue, the September-October issue, I lose track of where I'm at, we've got the first of what I hope are going to be a long series, not every issue, but periodically some more articles by Scotty. So once you've written and you get the sense for how much fun it is to be published in QEX, it'll just turn you on and you'll become a regular author. And that's what I'm looking for, is some people to continuously want to write some articles and share your good work. So I encourage you, and thanks for that. Look forward to talking with you this weekend.
And then you too can someday be a QEX editor. All right, so I'm trying to think to myself what we need to talk about next, and the most important thing is where the bathrooms are. That was a joke, folks. You're supposed to laugh at that. Got to work on that. Yeah, we're not awake yet. So, of course, out the door, take a right, take a left, take another right, take another left, okay? So it's a bit of a maze here, but it's a really nice property we're in here. And then the demo room is, you go out the doors here, take a left, and it's actually on the other side of that air wall there. So when we have playtime later on this afternoon. One real quick question. How many people here have been to the DCC before? Okay, how many here for the first time? Wonderful, and we're glad to have you, and we hope you really enjoy. If you got any questions, please let us know. Come talk with us. Let us know how we're doing. Let us know what we can do better. All right, up for our first speaker, we have Bruce Perrins, K6BP for AMBE Exposed. Take it away, Bruce.
And here's the finished product. Always tough to see a dipole wire on video. I can never tell whether I'm seeing it when I look at the monitor. But, whoa, it's tied off down there. There you can see it tied off down there. A neighbor secured permission. In fact, he is ex-Signal Corps, so... He said he was talking to his girlfriend, and she was asking what we were doing as we were doing all this before we talked to them, and he said, well, you're putting up antennas. So up to there, with a little weed eater line acting as a standoff, across the top, see the feed line there in the middle, and then, I'm sure you can't see down there, but we are tied off again down, it's a smoother zoom, Gary. I think we're tied off on that one of those two posts down there, maybe that far post. Again, with permission from that neighbor. Weed eater line doesn't tie very well. It's all grainy knots and, you know, kind of loose stuff. But now you can see the dipole heading up there, and it is, well, it's a little too low to the ground to be magnificent, but what the heck, it's magnificent. And the twin lead just drops down through the floor. And here we are below decks. This is the door into the studio, the bedroom I've made a studio. Getting through doors, weather seals and stuff can be an issue. This is metal. That might be a problem. You cross metal like that at right angles, you're at least doing the best you can. And the weather seal here is not too tight. So we'll just see what happens. I'll bet we hardly even know. And there's the studio with a pretty darn rough view out the window. Okay, here's the twin lead coming in. Since this is such a short run, we've got lots of extra and we don't want to use that all piled up. But looky here, there was already a splice. So we'll just cut into the splice, and it just happens to be the right length to make it to the back of the tuner. So I'll do that, hook things up, and see how we look.
And here I am in the studio. I got to tell you, I began recording the antenna installation on Sunday. It is now Wednesday. Things have not gone swiftly here, but let me show you what's going on. This is the The wrong picture. This is the studio setup. Over here is Wirecast audio mixer. Here's the radio stuff. I've got a camera mounted on a very expensive camera mount here. Can you see that? Yeah, the Solo Cup camera mount, and it's pointed at the 756 Pro 3, and so we can get on the air with it. With all that, though, and the bands have been pretty good for a while. Let's see if we're hearing anything right now on 17. Not so good right now. Somebody was on there. There we go. But look at this, an S7 noise level. And I think that, there we go, an S7 noise level. I think I know what's causing it, at least some of what's causing it. It's the cable TV stuff. I got a box here. Let me grab. I'll be right back.
No, it's wired in.
It's wired in. I can't get it over here very well. I got this one turned off, but the rest of them in the house are turned on. Because, you know, I can't turn off television for all the rest of the family. So if I do shut all that stuff off, that noise level drops down pretty low. Anyway, it's working okay. If one ham station at a beach house is good, though, two ham stations are better, especially when there's two hams. So we also put together a ham station for my father-in-law, Mac, W4PVT, and he's using not a totally unique antenna, but an antenna that is configured different than what you see most people do. He's using a dipole. It's mounted vertically. So this is it. It's not a wire dipole. It's made of two metal pipes, you know, sort of, you know, lightweight metal pipe. Little dowel rod in the middle to keep them separated. Once again, it's fed by twin lead, so he can use it on all bands. It's a total of about 30 feet long. He's able to load it up with an automatic tuner, an LDG tuner that we got for him at last Christmas that he loves. And even though it's fairly short, it tunes up on 40. He can get it to tune up on 60. I don't know if he's got much of a signal. We haven't tried talking to people, but the LDG tuner did handle it on 60. And then 40, and then on 20, 15, 17, 12, and 10, it works really great. And he has been working DX and talking to people all over the country like crazy with it. So he's having a lot more time to play with his stuff than I am play with my stuff, and it's doing better. I do video of this part, except that I'm running way behind on getting this episode out. I have run up and down stairs. He's upstairs and I'm downstairs, and listen to a signal he's listening to and listen to one the way I hear it down here. And on the higher bands, most of the time he's getting a better signal by a couple of S units, you know, something significant. It's not night and day, but it is somewhere between twilight and noon. So that's doing good. There's one more thing I want to cover here. Well, there's two more things I want to cover. I want to go back to the TAPR stuff briefly, and I'll repeat this in the next episode. The next episode, 167, is going to be Bruce Perrins. He's going to do Ambi Exposed, talking about the Ambi vocoder and lots of other stuff in terms of where we're going with this digital voice thing in ham radio. I'll repeat this in that episode, especially when I'm doing the Kickstarter stuff. I'm not going to do that here. I had promised the Kickstarter people an exclusive 30-day window of watching the programs. And then when I put out the program on Flex, I decided not to wait. For one thing, I edited it while I was sitting down there at the hotel room in Austin, and I wanted to get online right away because it seemed to be something fairly newsworthy. So then I thought, well, I wonder about the rest of the programs. And I put out an email to the folks that had supported the Kickstarter and said, what do you think? Because a few folks said, put them all out right away. Don't wait. A few folks had just said that. So I asked everybody else and said, what do you think? Should I just put them all out or not? And there's 150 or so folks that have been in the Kickstarter, and I got responses from maybe about 15 or 20. So most of them didn't say anything. But the 15 or 20 who responded were unanimous. Everybody said the whole idea of TAPR and open source is being open. Exclusivity is not part of our goal, not part of our mindset. So while it was nice to offer, and I was trying to offer something to people, because in Kickstarter they say that you need to give people something to be in order to entice them to support the Kickstarter, to be a backer, to just put their money in. So you got to give them something. And I'm giving people who have reached a certain level, the $100 or $150 level, a little USB stick that's got the programs on it. That's one thing. I was racking my brain for something I could give everybody. And I thought, well, some time to watch the thing that everybody else doesn't get for a while. That should be cool. And wasn't even thinking that I stepped over that boundary of not being open about it. So at least to begin with, I'm going to put the programs on right away. I'm going to violate the sacred pledge that I made to everybody, because they're pretty much telling me to. And we'll see if anybody has a problem with that. I did get one response from one person who said, well, be careful. He didn't have a problem with it, but he said, you did make that promise. You should be careful. You might make people mad. But it appears that I'm not only not making people mad, but I'm making them happier by putting the stuff out right away. So at least to begin with, for the first next few episodes from TAPR, I won't wait. Put them online right away. And there should be several coming up over the next couple of weeks. It'd probably still take into December before I get to the very tail end. So the last thing I wanted to mention was, again, the 756 Pro 3. I had a weird thing happen. You may have noticed in the past couple episodes, if you watched the picture very carefully, that first of all, it wasn't turned on. And second, it was kind of sitting up closer off the shelf from where it normally sits. And the reason was it was overheating. And I thought, you know, something's gone wrong. Duh. Maybe I lost the fan. You know, I have a lot of room above the radio and a few inches behind it. So it shouldn't accumulate heat. And yet I thought that was what was happening. So that's why I pulled it out. No, that didn't help. It was still hot. So I turned it off. I normally had left it sitting on a lot of the time, not all the time, but kind of sat on so I could go listen to something at a moment's notice and, you know, find out what the bands were like. And I hadn't noticed that heat before. I mean, I'm talking about too hot to touch, reaching around to the back panel. That picture up there, you know, reaching around to the back there. I can't quite reach, but, you know, way around to the back. It was like too hot to touch. I hadn't noticed that before. So I thought, you know, something was weird. So I turned the radio off and thought, okay, it's going to be okay. I'll go back and play with it again later. And maybe a few hours later, maybe the next day, it was still too hot. It was off and it was too hot. And I looked over at the Astron power supply that's supplying power for that radio and for some VHF, UHF radios, several of them. And it was sitting at about 4 or 5 amps. I thought that seems a little bit high for just radios in receive. So I pulled the power connector and it dropped like 3 amps right away. So I'm going, appliance operator, something is wrong. And so at a club dinner, I asked one of our local guys who does a lot of radio repair for people and especially interested in power supplies, what he thought. And he wasn't sure, but he and some other hams, some local hams, passed the word around, and somebody got back to them and they got back to me that there is a problem with the 756 Pro 3 and probably other radios in the driver transistor. If the driver transistor shorts out, the radio will conduct a lot of current and develop a lot of heat back, and it's in that part of the radio that the driver transistor lives, even if it's turned off. Because the power switch, you know, this, is that in? No, it's not quite in. move the solo cup there. The power switch is not a physical switch in terms of opening the power circuit. It's a soft electronic switch that, you know, tells the software guts to shut things off. But power is still connected to that driver transistor and probably a few other things inside the radio and maintaining memories and things. So they said replacing the drivers is probably going to solve it. So not something that I was really interested in doing, myself being an appliance operator. Thank you, Bruce. Next episode. And the fellow that was giving me the advice also didn't feel up to replacing the driver transistors. It turns out he probably could have, but he, you know, not really interested in doing that. He's a pretty busy guy too. So I contacted some folks. Let me switch them up on the web here. I contacted a fellow that does a service facility that was recommended to me. It's Paul Hansen, W6XA. He does a radio service out of his shop in South Carolina. That is Paul. And there's his pretty well-equipped shop. And if you read through his website, he's very straightforward about... Push the right button here. There we go. Push that button. He's pretty straightforward about what he does and what he doesn't do and what you need to think about before you send a radio in to get fixed. So I sent an email to him and I said, folks have said it probably the driver transistors. What do you think? And he said he agreed. It probably was. He also said those parts are no longer manufactured and are getting expensive and hard to find. And I did a little bit of investigation at DigiKey and Mauser and stuff. And yeah, they're pretty expensive. You can see them on eBay pretty cheap. Don't know if they're quality components or not. I don't do a lot of eBay shopping. I asked Paul, I said, I have the old 756 original by any chance. And I stopped using that because its display was fading out and it had some problems, but nothing with the transmitter. The internal antenna tuner had gone bad. And the 756 Pro 3 came out and it was a much better radio. So I bought that, feeling flush with the money I was making from being the Travelocity announcer guy for a few years. The 756 original had just been gathering dust on a shelf, and I asked him if it was the same driver transistors, and he said they were. So we talked about me sending the radio down. I was thinking I'm going driving right by on the way to Austin. Maybe I could drop it off, save shipping, make it easy, and pick it up on the way back. And he said that would be a good plan. Unfortunately, he wasn't going to be around that week. So that plan got delayed until I got back. And then I got to thinking, well, you know, Jeff does a lot of technical work, and he might help me out with this. He loves doing this sort of thing. And he told me after he finished it, he said, "Yeah, I really like doing this, but he's very busy, and I hate to ask." So I took the old radio and the they're both old radios. The 756 Pro 3 is like 7 years old and out of production, and the original Pro is over 10 years old and long out of production. So I took both radios over to Jeff's place and. And he popped them open and looked inside, and it was going to be pretty easy to do. So he took the transistors out. They are 2SC1972s, I think, is the transistor. He popped them out, put them in the new radio, and I keep saying new radio. He took them out of the older radio and put them in the less old radio, and everything has been working fine ever since. The thing I wanted to show was what he did as he was taking the transistors out and putting them in. First, he had to take the old transistors out from the Pro. And so he had to remove those. And here are some pictures that I took of Jeff doing that extraction. And the thing that impressed me is that when he got the transistors out, it looked like there had never been anything mounted there before. I'd never seen that. If I desolder something, I always leave a big blob of solder behind. I might use some solder wick and clean it up some, but it never looks this clean. So I took some pictures of it as I was starting to see this look so immaculate. and I thought about doing the repair as a show. And lately, one of my things is that every time I try to do something as a show, it takes 10 times longer than it does to actually do it. And we didn't have a lot of time the evening that he was working on it. So I just took some pictures with my camera. And I thought, well, I'll talk to Jeff and have him explain what you're seeing in the pictures and what he did. So here I am down at the beach. Jeff is in Chicago at a hotel room. I said, let's try Skype. He can't get Skype to work. Let's try a Google Hangout. He's never done that. We both have so many identities, especially me and Google. We were never sure who we were talking to. We both got Hangouts going, but I would call him. He wouldn't see it. He would call me. I wouldn't see it. I don't know. He tried recommending some meeting thing, not go to meeting, but some meeting thing that he's had some success with. And it was going to show a little picture of him, and that was at least going to be a little picture of him that you could see. And well, here's how that worked out. This is the hardest video conference I have ever set up. This is Jeff, and it's like when I was looking at CQ magazine, I could put it on the screen, but I couldn't put it into the Wirecast system. You guys couldn't see it. So that's what's coming up here with Jeff. So this is the only way you guys are going to see Jeff in this tiny little picture. He couldn't get Skype to work. We tried Google Hangouts. We couldn't get Google Hangouts to work. We couldn't figure that out. We're both way too old for Google Hangouts. So what is this that we're looking at?
Well, it's just a video conferencing circuit. And it works through a real low width, so it'll work from a hotel. I'm in a hotel in Chicago tonight, and
So it didn't work out. So finally, I just called him on the phone. I used Skype, just dialing to his phone, and you can't see him, but you'll hear him. And we talked about what he did. Hey. Can you hear me now?
That's on the speaker. Am I coming through okay?
You're coming through fine.
Okay.
This is the worst telephonic internetic communication I've ever encountered. It's incredible. So we tried Skype. Skype didn't work. We tried Google Hangouts. We couldn't figure out how to make that work. And then we tried this go to Just Meet or something, and that didn't work. So
one of them needs to learn some technology.
One of us. So I'll put up pictures of what we're doing, and people aren't going to see you because now I called you on Skype on just your cell phone because Skype's not working anywhere else. So what we're trying to get at is the magic, the desoldering magic that you did when you fixed my 756 Pro 3. I've told people what the deal was, what the problems were. So you got in there because I wasn't about to do this. And I'm really glad I didn't because you made it look like no one had ever soldered on those transistor lands before. How did you do that?
Well, it was with chemistry. It's better living through chemistry. What I did, you know, the challenge for bigger components like that is kind of the same one as like when you're soldering PL259s. There's a lot of metal there, and you got to get all of that metal up to the solder melting temperature. And so with something like that circuit board, you know, your choices are a large wattage soldering iron that can heat up that much metal enough to melt all the solder, but that's so hard on everything. You know, it wants to take the lands off the printed circuit board and all of that. So a better solution is to reduce the melting point of the solder, and that's what I did. I used an element called bismuth, and this bismuth just has a really strange property in that it can reduce the melting point of the solder to about 160 or 170 degrees. In the form I use it, it looks like solder itself. So all you do is put a little bit of flux on the transistor's terminals, which you saw when we were doing it, and then melt the connection with the soldering iron and apply a little bit of this bismuth. And it only takes a little, just maybe 50% of the volume of the solder that's already on the connection. If you can add that much more with the bismuth, it reduces the melting point to about 160, 170 degrees. You can quite literally wash the components off the printed circuit board with hot water when you do that. But because the temperature is so low, you know, you can remove the soldering iron and put it away, and you've got a good 20 or 30 seconds to remove the part before the, you know, the remaining alloy solidifies again. So it's real easy to get the part off, and then to clean up the board, I just use solder wick. It's just a copper braid that's got some flux on it, and it just absorbs solder, and that's what I use. And then, you know, all that flux was all over, making a sticky mess on the board, so I just wiped that off with some acetone. Alcohol will work. It just doesn't work as quick.
What's the stuff in the green stuff in the syringe? What was that?
Yeah, that's a real sticky flux. It's similar to the resin that's inside solder, but it's just flux. The reason I use that stuff is because it's really sticky, and we didn't need it to be sticky for removing the parts, but with little tiny parts, yeah, when you stick them on the board, you know, especially if it's a chip that's got many, many close space leads to it, once you get that thing placed right, you don't want it moving around while you try to solder it, so that flux is sticky, and you can stick chips down with it, and then they won't move while you're trying to solder them, but it's just flux.
Okay. What does that bismuth look like? Oh, you said it looked like solder, like in a roll, like solder.
Yeah, it looks just like solder. It comes in 6-inch lengths, smaller, a little bit smaller than the 16th-inch diameter, probably 50,000th diameter, a little less than 16th-inch solder, and it's kind of expensive. I get it from a company called Chip Quick. It's CHIP Quick. I don't know if that's CWIK or QUIK or what, but Chip Quick, and that's where that flux is from, to the same people.
All right, and I was looking through the pictures that I took with my phone, and I don't see a picture of you doing that. So it looks like that is, you add it as if you are soldering something. You do it with the soldering iron. You heat up the joint, add this stuff, and then suddenly things melt like crazy.
Yeah. You got to get it hot enough to initially melt the solder, but it only has to be that hot for a few seconds, and it doesn't have to be, you know, the entire connection. Now, in the case of your driver transistors, that's a TO220 case, so it had the three leads out the bottom, but then the back, you know, the case itself, the metal plate on the back of the case, I think, was soldered down, and I can't remember because it's been too long. But in a case like that, you only have to get one corner hot enough, you know, for the solder to start to mix with the bismuth, and then that whole connection will just will meld, and, you know, it'll flow its way across there in just a couple of seconds. And then you can take your time removing it with very little stress to the components or the board or anything else.
So the key elements here were using the bismuth to melt things quick and easy, using the solder wick to pull the excess solder off the lands and make them look pretty clean, and then using you could use alcohol, but you used what?
I used just acetone.
From the hardware store. Okay, and that's what did the final cleaning and made the lands look like nothing had ever soldered to them before.
Yeah. That's what the sticky brown stuff off from around the lands. It was the solder wick that cleaned. That cleaned off the pads, you know, where the transistor solder. See, when you put the bismuth with it and it lowers the melting temperature, it makes that stuff absorb into the solder wick better than just ordinary solder. So they come out cleaner than they would have if it was just ordinary solder on there. And that's what made it look like a brand new circuit board.
So George has never mentioned this that I've seen on Smoke and Solder. I guess smoke and solder is not necessarily smoke and desolder, is it?
No, but for most applications, you don't really need all that. You know, there's extra flux and bismuth and all that. What it's good for is if you do a lot of surface mount stuff, especially things with real high lead density. That's when these little tricks are so valuable. But the bismuth, you know, with the TO220 case, even though it could have easily been done without it, it just reduces the stress on everything, so it's real beneficial to use it.
So it may have actually done something useful, but it clearly looked good.
Oh, yeah, it makes everything look good. Yeah, it sure does.
Okay. How did you learn how to do this?
It was a few years ago when I was called upon to do a couple of new designs for the company I work at. I wanted to use surface mount technology and move away from the through hole stuff that they had been doing for years. And so that required, you know, soldering with hot air and tweezers and all these cool tools that I always wanted to learn about but had never had a chance to.
So you just taught yourself, self-taught.
Yeah, I taught myself. You know, there's tutorials on YouTube on how to do all that stuff, and those are so valuable, you know, especially the first time. But most, you know, soldering techniques and all, you can be taught by other people, but after you do it a time or two, you know, you see how to do it, you develop your own techniques, and it's not uncommon. I mean, everybody that does that type of work has learned to solder. Maybe got a few pointers from somebody to get started, but most people learn themselves.
How come I've never learned this stuff?
You've been operating.
Bruce Perrins is going to call me an appliance operator in the next video, so stay tuned for that. He's going to expose the ambi vocoder, and he's going to expose me. So, all right, Jeff. Well, thank you very much. You're in Chicago, right?
Yeah, I'm in Chicago, and I had Richmond Monday and Waukegan yesterday, in Chicago today, and going home tomorrow.
I feel like Phil Donahue. Is the caller there, Chicago? Are you? No, that was Larry King. That wasn't Phil Donahue.
So, oh, okay.
All right. We need to get our communications technology working better. We need to work on that.
Okay.
Somehow.
Don't
try to figure this stuff out on the fly when you're trying to get an interview done. Well, they do that on Twitter all the time. They always have trouble.
Do you still have the video?
Yeah, I'm going to stick that in there for a second.
Oh, okay.
All right. I'll see you, Jeff.
Goodbye, everybody.
Bye-bye. All right. Thank you, Jeff. So I've got a working radio again, sitting down here at the beach, not much time to play with it. We're about to head out to dinner, and we've got a pretty busy day scheduled tomorrow, and I've got to get this episode edited and get it online. So I guess that's it for now. Mac's having a great time upstairs playing with his radio and the vertical antenna that's out there.
Thank you a lot, Dennis, and good luck to you there. 73-AA-0A-W4-PBT.
73-AA-0A, clear.
If you feel so motivated, go visit hamradionow.tv. See over there, Arvin, click the pig. You can send some money to Arvin, stick it in his little coin slot there, and he will take his cut off the top and send the rest to me. And I can spend more time making these programs. Oh, boy. Back to the beach. I want to go ride my bike. This is Ham Radio Now. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ73. Over. And back to Austin.